Today lecture is left ventricle unloading during V ECMO. It's one of the most important lecture in managing patient with VA ECMO. Managing patient on peripheral VA ECMO is a challenge. We need to balance between increasing the flow and unload the heart. Sometimes we are in need to increase the flow so as to avoid end organ dysfunction, and that will happen when there is increased oxygen consumption, increasing lactate, increased central venous pressure, decreased urine output, oxygen demand less than oxygen delivery, decreased pulsatility on arterial blood pressure, and decreased mean arterial blood pressure. And when we have need to unload the heart to allow more myocardial recovery, that will happen when we have echo, increase in echo dimension, presence of mitral rigor, increased pulmonary capillary with pressure, and smoking effect. All of these needed to be considered in case of peripheral VA ECMO, and not present if we use central venous arterial. So now we will go for ECMO or ECMO plus to unload the heart. Before going to the lecture, I will put some definition, important definition I will use. Cardiac power output, that's mean arterial blood pressure, multiplying cardiac output with a constant 0.022. Pulmonary artery pulsatility index, it means pulmonary artery systolic minus pulmonary artery diastolic divided by right atrial pressure. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will reflect left ventricle and diastolic pressure. Ventricular function during VA ECMO. The goal for native heart, first, preload reduction, and we can achieve that by increasing ECMO flow, diuresis, and positive pressure ventilation. Second, afterload reduction, by decreased ECMO flow or giving diuresis, positive pressure ventilation, decrease mean arterial blood pressure, and decrease systemic vascular resistance. Third, increase the contractility by myocardial disease improvement and using inotropes. The mean hemodynamic target for VA ECMO is to achieve right ventricular decompression and prevent left ventricular distension. That will happen by ECMO, which drain blood from right atrium. So that will lead to decrease right ventricular preload, lead to the right ventricular decompression. Right ventricular decompression will lead to decrease left ventricular preload, and that will achieve small amount of left ventricular decompression. But in peripheral VA ECMO, the blood will return back into aorta, and that will increase left ventricle afterload, lead to increased left ventricular distension, and pulmonary edema will happen. Persistent drainage of tibetan vein and bronchial veins into left atrium not drained by ECMO, so LV distension will be happened. Effect of VA ECMO on left ventricle myocardium: decrease venous return and the volume work, reduce the wall tension of the heart. So it will decrease the left ventricle end diastolic volume and left ventricle end diastolic pressure. Increasing the MAP and the reduction of venous pressure will improve the pressure gradient and the myocardial perfusion. On the other side, increased blood pressure will increase afterload and increase the pressure work of myocardium, affecting the Frank-Starling loop. So when we have increased afterload, that will increase left ventricle end diastolic pressure, will lead to left ventricle distension and increased left atrial pressure, and pulmonary edema will occur. Another thing, there will increase left ventricle distension, will increase wall tension, increase oxygen consumption, will lead to subendocardial ischemia and arrhythmia. Left ventricle distension will reduce ejection fraction and lead to blood stasis and lead to thrombosis and shuffling. What are factors driving the need for unloading for patient? If patient has fluid overload, we can give him diuresis. But in presence of high pulsatility and LV extension of ECHO and after hemodynamic assessment, so we should consider to unload the patient. But if any of these factors like smoking effect or slow flow through mitral valve, absent pulsatility, or low ejection or absent ejection fraction, here unloading is mandatory or needed. What's the effect of ventricular distension? If you have ventricular distension, so there is, will be myocardial ischemia, intracardiac thrombus, pulmonary edema. It may occur after initiating ECMO or later due to disease course or improper management of heart failure or improper management of ECMO itself. Detect left ventricle overload by ECHO, low ejection fraction, increased left end diastolic pressure, and insufficient aortic opening. Monitor of ventricular function. Why we need it? Detecting ventricular function, detect its tension, and poor forward flow. What are data reflecting ventricular function? Pulse pressure more than 10 mm mercury, central venous pressure is then 12 mm mercury, ventilatory parameters improving the compliance, chest x-ray improving pulmonary edema, differential hypoxemia, that means that the lung is still diseased and the heart is improved. ECHO, stable or decreased in left ventricle and right ventricle and diastolic volume, improving left ventricle and right ventricle function, aortic valve opening every 3 beats. Detection of left ventricle distension in peripheral VA ECMO can be done by decreased pulse pressure less than 10, increased CVP, presence of pulmonary edema, and increased end diastolic diameters. This can be treated by non-invasive measurement like ensuring perfusing rhythm. If increased CVP or suspected hypervolemia, we should use diuresis. If increased systemic vascular resistance, we can decrease the vasopressors if the MAB is tolerated or using vasodilator. Decrease ECMO flow if we have a good MAB, good urine output, and central venous oxygen saturation. All of these will allow good coronary perfusion, and we can also restart inotropes and increase the dose of inotropes. If we have left ventricle extension and previous non-invasive measurement is failed, so we will go for left ventricle vent. Maybe we use Impella, which is macroaxial pump, taking the blood from left ventricle through a aortic valve to the ascending aorta, or using an aortic balloon, or atrial septostomy, which drain blood from left atrium to right atrium. Cannula can be placed in left atrium or left ventricle or pulmonary vein, drain the blood into the circuit if centrally cannulated. These devices used in left ventricle unloading, starting from intra-aortic balloon till atrial unloading, we will explain each one. Using intra-aortic balloon with ECMO is for left ventricular venting, so it augments pulsatility, decrease afterload and improve blood flow in native coronaries and bypass the graft. It was noted that when you use intra-aortic balloon with ECMO, we will have cardiac surgery better survival. Based on shock trial, cardiac power output may be the best predictor of the effectiveness of intra-aortic balloon during impending cardiogenic shock. If cardiac power output is low, we should upgrade to Impella. Then we will go for Impella. We are going for Impella. Impella is a catheter-based transaortic axial flow pump introduced percutaneously through a femoral approach. Then the device passed through aortic valve, so taking the blood from the left ventricle to ascending aorta. There are models or pumps from the Impella, Impella 2.5 and Impella CP or Impella 5. We can pump the blood from 2.5 to 5 liters per minute. For Impella 5, it can be placed surgically and it can be placed through axillary artery when we need to ambulate the patient. If we combine Impella with ECMO, it's called ECPILLA. If we combine Impella with ECMO, it's called ECPella. And if the patient has low cardiac power output before inserting ECMO, less than 0.6 watt and pulmonary artery pulse index less than 0.9, we should push toward a biventricular support. This will help to unload the left ventricle. In this picture, this is the shape of Impella device, and this is the shape of Impella during insertion in angio. In angiogram or through a fluoroscopy. Third part is of left ventricle unloading is simple ECMO, decrease the flow on ECMO site. Ventricular unload or atrial unload, which is better? We can go for ventricular unload if we have low or absent stroke volume and or low or absent left ventricular contractility. Atrial unloading should be done if we have aortic rigor or mitral rigor. Atrial unloading, it's done through percutaneous left atrial septostomy. The shunt can be created artificially with percutaneous plate or balloon septostomy under guidance of transesophageal echo. The blood drain from left atrium to drain into right atrium to be drained via venous cannula. This is common in treating pediatric patient. Ventricular unloading, this is left atrium or left ventricle directly cannulated, allowed blood to be vented into the venous arm of the circuit. We can do transition to BiVAD, tandem heart or Santori Mag considered if we not need oxygenator. The use of left ventricular assisted device like Impella or Bipella left and right, Impella and using Impella RP for the right side can also provide left ventricular decompression. The effect of left ventricular unloading is four effects. First, decrease left atrial pressure, and that will lead to resolution of pulmonary edema and decrease right ventricular afterload. And the second effect is opening of aortic valve. Third effect, it will decrease left ventricle pressure and improving coronary blood flow and helping in giving a chance for myocardial recovery. On another hand, it will decrease in wall tension or stress, decrease the ischemic threshold, decrease myocardial work and energy consumption, and that will help in increasing the chance for myocardial recovery. Left ventricular venting can be done through atrial or ventricular unloading. This can be done through surgical techniques, sternotomy to access pulmonary vein, pulmonary artery, left atrium, and left ventricle. Minimal invasive technique through subsevoid or right anterolateral incision or left anterolateral incision. Percutaneous technique, which through pulmonary artery vent, or transseptal septostomy or cannula, ventricular venting through Impella, transaortic vent, or and tandem heart. This simple algorithm how to manage VA ECMO and keep eyes on left ventricular distension. If there is no left ventricular distension, so it will be daily monitoring and keep check pulmonary artery, capillary wedge pressure if there is increasing dosing of VA ECMO. But if there is distension, we will check. If there is no pulmonary edema, we will optimize general measures on ECMO like iotropic support, restrict volume, maintain the lowest perfusing map. But if there is aortic rigor, no ejection, smoking effect, we should consider unloading. If we have pulmonary edema and we have high recovery potential, so we will go for left ventricular unloading with Impella. But if we have pulmonary edema, and still we don't have hope for recovery like ischemic cardiomyopathy with poor revascularization or dilated cardiomyopathy, we should go for transition for LVAD or temporary BiVAD. What are the complications of left ventricle venting? Bleeding, perforation, thrombosis of in left ventricle or left atrium, cannula or catheter, hemolysis, dislodgement of the device, aortic valve closure. Regarding the reference, this is the most important paper in left ventricle unloading. It's flow optimization and management and to prevent left ventricle stenosis during V ECMO. I recommend to read it. Thank you, and I'm waiting for your question in the comments.